Let me have your attention for just a minute. I have some 4x6 cards out here. So I want everybody to have a 4x6 card in their hand. If you don't have a pen, we'll give you a pen. Just in case you meet somebody here, you meet three new people, people you never met before, got their names, something about them. You have to be eligible for a prize. I got all these prizes. All these prizes sitting around here on the table, about 30-some prizes I'll give away for various kinds of things. I was going to give it to the good-looking women, but we had so many good-looking women. I don't think I have enough prizes for all these good-looking women. So anyway, get one of these cards, write their name down, and this is how I met a lot of these folks here, because I went to a fair and met, and I'll tell you about that later, how that worked. And write their name down, meet some people. You have two doctors here. You have two doctors here. You have a couple lawyers here. You have some social workers here, teachers here, school administrators here, two pastors here. We have, that means you have two pastors' wives. So if you find out, you go around who they are, put it on your sheet, you'll meet some interesting people. That's just how we do. This is the state way. Okay, so I'll let you go on and I'll get back to you later. Thank you.
Well, in the neighborhood, a lady had a real nice pet cat. And the cat passed away. Cat passed away, breathing on the deep. So she went to the Methodist church, talked to the Methodist principal, asked her if he had a funeral for her cat. He told her no, talked nasty to her, said, go and have a nice day. See you later. So she went to Episcopal church. And asked that pastor, he said the same thing. We don't have funerals for cats. Have a nice day. So she went to the Presbyterian church and talked to the Presbyterian minister. So, same thing. Have a nice day, lady. See you later. She said, well, I'm getting frustrated, man. I'm going to pay somebody $1,000 to have a funeral for my cat. He said, wait a minute, come back. You should have told me your cat was Presbyterian. Went to the barber shop to get a haircut. Had his haircut, and the barber asked me, "You ready to go on vacation, Bill?" "Yes, sir. Going to Rome. See the boat." He said, "Bill, this time of year is nasty over there. It's too crowded. And besides, you might not get to see the boat." "Okay, I'm going anyway." So he gets on the flight, goes to Rome, gets down there, sees the boat, up on that ledge, and somebody comes by and taps him on the shoulder. "So, sir, the Pope wants to see you. Could you come up and talk to the Pope?" So he went up, talked to the Pope, and later on in the month, he's back home. So the barber asked him, he says, "Bill, did you go to Rome?" "Yeah, but you didn't see the Pope, did you?" "Oh yeah, I saw the Pope. He blessed me, and he counseled me and everything." "Well, out of all those 1,000 people, why would he ask you to come up?" "He said, I had the worst haircut he ever seen."
Well, being a stand-up comic, you know, it's not easy. Harry Brown, when I was going to Swarthmore High School, Harry Brown played on Ridley Townsend's football team. And that's how we met. And not many years, that's 60 years ago. He was on the football team. He was an awesome halfback. He couldn't stop me, of course, but he stopped everybody else but me. Because Harry was very fast in those days. I even have the guy who high jumped with me in Bartram, Courtney. Raise your hand, Courtney. That's Courtney Carter. That's how I know him. We go all the way back to Bartram. Only went there 1 year in 1954. And Courtney was on the track team, and we were high jumpers. Of course, I was better than Courtney. You know that. But anyway, we were high jumpers on the team. Now both of us on sticks. He's like, my nephew said, "Yeah, I heard you used to jump 6'6", 6'7" in your street clothes." He said, "Yeah, but you couldn't jump over a puff of smoke now." I said, "Yeah, I can't jump over a puff of smoke, but I still got an advantage over you." He said, "What's that?" "I can remember when I could jump. You never could jump." Now, who's gonna be the next one? Okay, Brenda. Brenda Gillison.
Hi, she was he was telling a joke about the religion that made me think of one. My uncle was the bishop of South Carolina.
The mic up closer.
Oh, my uncle was the bishop of South Carolina. He just resigned after 50 years. Bishop of South Carolina. So when we went to his retirement party, he had someone there that was the master of ceremony, and he told the joke. And I thought it was very funny. So when this one, I'm sorry, when Harry, the person that just left, Harry Brown, told a religious joke that made me think of this, so I thought I would share. It made us laugh. So there were two gentlemen, and they were lost on the island. And one of them was saying, "We're never going to get off this island. We don't have any flares. No one knows where we're at. We're just sunk. We're going to die." So his partner said, "I make $100,000 a week." So he said, "What does that have to do with it? It's not going to do you no good now. We're going to die. Nobody's going to find us. We don't have anything. White flags. We just don't have anything. Our boat's sunk. Nobody's going to know where we're at. We have no way to contact them. We're going to die." So his friend said, "I make $100,000 a week." He said, "What is the point of bragging about how much you make now? Your money's not going to do you any good. You know, this is one of the times where your money's not going to do you any good. So you make $100,000, so what be?" He said, "We're going to die on this island. You're going to die with your $100,000 a week." His partner said, "No, you don't get it. I make $100,000 a week. I tithe. My preacher's going to find me." I wish y'all gave me a little bit of that. We got a hard crowd tonight. Oh, that was big for Henry.
Okay. Don't tell me. That was a surprise, right?
Henry would find me if I got lost.
Well, I don't know whose laugh was weaker, hers. Okay.
This joke is not about a minister. This is about a group of people who were flying in the air. And the pilot came across the loudspeaker and said, "This plane is imbalanced. There's too much weight. I would have to throw something overboard." So he threw the luggage overboard. And he came back on the loudspeaker again. "It's still too much weight. So we're going to have to get rid of some of the people. So I'm going to do it alphabetically." So he started with the A. Anybody who's African American? Throw them out. Nobody said anything. Then he went on to the letter B. Anybody who's black? Throw them out. Nobody said anything. So the next letter was C. Anybody who's colored, throw yourselves out. And this little girl was with her mother. She said to her mother, "Isn't he talking about us?" The mother replied, "We niggas tonight."
Well, that's a good one. That's a good one. All right, who's next? Now we have, man, this thing, makes that thing printed up. I know, as well as I know Ruth Johnson. That's her husband sitting over there in my chair. I've had that special chair for him because he just got out of the hospital and he wasn't supposed to stay. He checked himself out just to come to my party. I told him he should have stayed in the hospital. But anyway, he's over here tonight and here's his wife, Ruth. Go ahead, do your thing, Ruth. Now we had three or four so far. And so far, I think Gillison got it.
Did you say I got it? Hey.
That's what's really pretty funny. There was a guy named Leroy. And Leroy would brag all the time, I know everybody. So he's like, he's always talking about he knows everybody. He don't know everybody. So these two guys got together and said, "Well, we're going to see if he knows everybody." So they said they were going to go to the game, the basketball, see the Cavaliers. So he said, "We're going to see who he knows here." So they were out on the basketball court, and LeBron James looked over and said, "Hey, Leroy, how you doing? If I knew you were coming, we would have had me and you and Mrs. had dinner." So they was looking at each other like, "What?" So he says, "Okay, let's take him to the Eagles game." So he took him to the Eagles game, and the Eagles game was in progress. And it was towards the end of the game. They said, "See, he don't know everybody." Next thing you know, LeSean McCoy came out. And as he was out doing his thing, he looked over and he said, "Hey, Leroy, how you doing? If I knew you was coming, I would have made you family got together afterwards. So he was like, dang, he just about knows everybody. He said, let's take him to the White House. So they took him to the White House, and as they were going through the White House, and they was touring and what have you, so towards the end, Obama comes out. So as Obama walked past, he says, Leroy, if I'd have known you were coming, Michelle and I would have had you over tonight for dinner. He was like, dang, he does know almost everybody. So let's take him over to Italy, to the Vatican. So it's all of these people out in the Vatican's yard. And so they had two nuns that looked up. And they were saying, on the balcony, who's that? Who's that Leroy up there with? Oh, he was with the Pope, but they didn't know the Pope. Okay. I love it. They said, who's up there with Leroy? It was the Pope. And the nuns didn't know the Pope, but they know Leroy.
They knew Leroy.
Yes. He's so popular.
Oh, that's what it is, really? Well, this is a contest. Now we had three or four people see if they can tell the best joke. And so far, it's, I don't know. There's been so little laugh, I don't know who to win. Anyway, we'll take Charlie Battle. Now, Charlie Battle went to Temple with me, and he's back there in the same line at Temple back in 1956, 54 to 58 when we were there. Anyway, Charlie, you got to win because nobody's gotten any laughs yet, hardly. Except Miss Gillison.
Charlie back.
Come on, Charlie, bring it. Bring it back.
Okay.
He's already up there.
I studied the dead course at Temple, mortuary science. So I got a job working at Goldstein's on Broad Street. We had a funeral one day, and old man, what's his name, Goldberg, he laid in the casket. He had three sons, Seymour, Saul, and Harry. His request was that at his funeral, he wanted each son to bring five $100 bills and place in his casket. So the first son, Seymour, came up, looked at him and said, Dad, rest in peace. And he counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That was his five $100 bills. The second one, Saul, came up. He did the same thing. Dad, rest in peace. And he counted out five $100 bills. Harry walked up, looked around, looked in. He reached in his pocket and he pulled out a book. Started writing a check out. Wrote a check out for $1,500. Picked up $1,000 and rest in peace, Dad, and make sure you spend it.
Okay. All right. Well, yes. Oh, here we go. Here's one. This is Debbie's husband. I guess he says the competition is so low, he's going to jump into this one. Okay. This is Ron. Close to the family.
What happened was, this young lady was driving down the highway, down south, back in the, you know, where it's dark and no lights. So what happens, she's running out of
gas. Can't hear you, Ryan.
Oh, this lady's driving down south, back in the wooded areas and stuff, down the highway, and she finds she's running out of gas. So she sees a little motel over there, so she decides she better pull in and find out where's the gas station. She goes in, she says to the guy, and as she's walking in, this little hillbilly guy comes out and he's going to one of the rooms. So she goes inside, she says, how far is the nearest gas station? He said, oh, about 30 miles down the road. So she says, oh my God. She said, well, do you have any rooms? He said, no, but I just rented my last room to that fellow going down there. So she goes outside. She sees the guy going in the room. She says, I can't go down this dark road. I got to see what's happening. She goes over. He's getting ready to go in the room. Little hillbilly guy. So she taps him on the shoulder. She says, pardon me, sir. He says, mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. He says, since you don't know me and I don't know you, do you think maybe we could share this room? So he says, okay, all right. So they go in. So he goes in the bedroom. So she says, I'll sleep on the sofa. So she goes in the sofa, knocks on the bedroom. But he goes in the bedroom. And so a few minutes go by. So she goes over and taps on the door. And he says, yeah. So he says, since you don't know me and I don't know you, you think maybe I could share a bed with you? So he says, okay. So she gets in the bed. He turns over and he's ready to go to sleep. She's laying there. She taps him on the shoulder. She says, you think since you don't know me and I don't know you, you think maybe we could have a little party? So he says, since you don't know me and I don't know you, who are we going to invite?
What did I do? I didn't get the end of the story. What was it? Give me that. Give me that. I didn't hear it.
She says to him,
because the competition has been so well, and he didn't get the response he wanted to further. He wants to give it another shot.
Okay, we're right in the park. Something like Central Park, New York. This cop is patrolling, and there's a couple out there, and the couple went behind the bushes and started having sex. So the cop comes along, arrests them, and take them into the precinct. And there were three boys that was watching them. We wanted the three boys to go and be witness for him at the courthouse. So when he got to the courthouse, the judge asked the first boy, who was a Caucasian, son, what did you see? He said, I saw these people laying on the grass and they were juggling with each other. Get out of my court, sir. You can't talk like that. So the next boy was a Spanish boy. So the judge asked him, what did you see? He says, two people right there, and they were humping and humping and humping. You can't talk like that in my court. You got to get out of my court. So the cop told the African-American boy, watch what you say, because I don't want you to get thrown out of court. So he took the stand. What did you see, son? Well, it was 10 toes up and 10 toes down. Two somebody's bodies were going round and round. Something was going in. Something was going out. If that ain't making love, you can throw me out.
If that ain't making love, you can throw me out. I like that. Now, we got Harry Brown at the top of the list and Miss Gillison. Now, which one? Give me a hand clap for Miss Gillison. Hand clap. Well, I had Gillison did pretty good too. Now, that's right. Give me one for Eloise Vaughn. Oh man, that's about the same. Now, what about Harry Brown? You know what the problem is? This crowd's old, they can't even clap. That's what I get for having all these old people come to clap. I think I'm about to give all three of them a prize. I got the numbers down here. Give them number 5, 6, and 7. 5, 6, and 7. On your table there are prizes with numbers on them. 5, 6, and 7. Now let me see. How are we going to serve? Everybody, are you ready in the kitchen? Ready in the kitchen? Oh, wait a minute. I do have a prize for the person here who is the oldest to attend my party. Oldest person. And we'll start at the age 70, 75, 80, 85, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, Darius, how old are you, Darius? Darius, how old are you?
She's
91. 92. He's the best looking 90. That's my fraternity brother, 92. He and his wife. But I thought when I sent out the invites that you folks would win. But you know you did not win. You know who won? I have here today a 97-year-old lady who came over when my sister and her husband, they didn't have a generator like I have. So my sister called me, the electric's off, all the stuff is off, like poor people, you know? And she called me, Lonnie, we sitting over here all cold and everything, can we come over to your house? I said, no, go down to the firehouse, that's where they have poor people down there. So she didn't want to go to the firehouse, so she came up, she and her husband came up for a couple of days, and they said, well, the lady across the street, she probably doesn't have a generator either. Maybe we ought to knock on her door. I said, who's she? Now you're going to bring the whole neighborhood? So anyway, they knocked on her door and brought her up. She is 97 years old, and she came up, played cards with Elaine and Debbie, beat them. She's sharper than they are, 97. And so I said, go ahead, girl. So I called Debbie, I said, well, you come to the party, bring Mrs. Selby to the party. Mrs. Selby, stand up so they can see who you are, please. And give her a hand. Step on out of here. That table so she can step out there. Okay. That's Mrs. Selby. And then we have Mrs. Selby's 97 years old. And go ahead, step out a little bit more. Everybody can see that beautiful green outfit you got on today.
Now, can I tell my joke?
What do you say, Mrs. Selby? Would you like to have a word to say to the group? Here, take her this mic. Oh, I forgot she does tell jokes. Oh, we might have to give up. You people have to give your prize back. All right. Here's Miss Selby telling her joke. Listen.
There was some nuns riding around in a car. They ran out of gas. Some nuns riding around in a car. They ran out of gas. So they went up to the gas station to get some gas, and the man says he didn't have nothing to help him with, because the last person he had given his can to carry gas, they didn't bring it back. So they went and looked in the trunk of their car, and they had a bedpan. So they took the bedpan back to the gasoline station, and he filled it with gasoline, and they went back and was pouring it in the trunk of the car. So two drunks came along and said, them sisters sure got a lot of faith. They had a lot of faith because they didn't know it was gasoline in the pan. They thought it was the bedpan that used to be there.
Thank you, Mrs. Selby. Thank you. And give her a hand for being 97 and can still remember the joke. Now we got to give her a prize. She gets two prizes. She's going to get two prizes because number one, she's 97. I have to give Darius and his wife one too, since they so close. You never know, that dude is 90-some years old over there. Darius, come on out here. He can jump up out the chair better than I can. I'm going to give you a choice, Miss Selby. Darius, say hi to the group. Say hi to the group.
Hi, everybody. Oh, it's quite a pleasure to be with you, and I'm glad that Lonnie remembered us, and I see several people from Grace. Everywhere I go, I see some Grace people, so that's always a pleasure. And, I had Luther Ball, and so I just well tell a joke to everybody else.
Keep the mic close to your mouth.
This minister was a young minister, with all due respect to Reverend Abbott back then. This young minister was going to preach his first sermon, so he was a little concerned about it. And one of the older members ministers told him, why don't you just get your glass of water? And every time you get a little concerned, just take a sip of water. So instead of a sip of water, he put a little glass of gin. Nobody knew the difference between gin and water. So he was really got going. And finally, when it was all over, he asked this other minister, how did he do? He said, you didn't do so poorly, but next time, remember, it was 12 disciples and not 10. And it was 10 commandments and not 12. And Samson didn't blow the Philistines away with them and lose it. He used the jawbone of an ass.
Give them a punchline again. A lot of them didn't get the punchline. Remember, these are old people in here. Half of them can't listen, the other can't see. Some can't hear. You know what I mean? That's how it is.
Very loud.
Gotta keep the mic to your mouth when you're talking.
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
What was the thing about the jawbone? I'm sitting right here.
Okay, the young minister asked the older minister, how did he do? And he said, you didn't do so poorly. But next time, remember that they were 10 commandments and not 12. And there were 12 disciples and not 10. And Samson didn't blow the Philistines away with an Uzi. He used the jawbone of an ass.
Thank you. Thank you. As you see, being a stand-up comedian is nice. Give him a hand. Elaine? My beautiful wife, step out here, beautiful. Come on out here. Spend all this money, you better come on out here. I want you to help me decide how do we organize to start eating. All right. Okay. Here's how we're going to do it. My wife is giving me the idea. We're ready. Here's how we're going to do it. We have, at the moment, two pastors here. I know you wouldn't know them to look at them. We got two pastors' wives and two of the most gorgeous women in the place. And then we got so many people here. I'm gonna have the two pastors step forward, and one's gonna bless first our house and our and you folks, and then the other one's gonna bless the food and whatever else. So we'll start with. Bruce Alec, Dr. Bruce Alec, step on up here. And we got Henry Chappelle. Where's Henry? Henry, step up here. Where is he? Oh, there he is. Hello. There you go.
My seminary teacher.
See that? There you go. So we have two pastors here. So be careful what you say now. These guys can take you on in or take you out.
Leave it up to the boss.
Reverend Bruce. What would you like to do? Just bless the house.
The house.
Okay.
Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we come to say thank you. You have clearly brought us a mighty long way.
Yes.
And Lord, in this season of our Savior's birth, we ask that you would bless this house, bless our host, bless his family. We thank you for each one who has walked through these doors. Bless them, my Father. Bless those who are preparing food. Bless, oh God, all of us with what you know we stand in need of.
Yes.
Lord, we can do nothing without you. And in this world where there is so much chaos and confusion, it reminds us that we need you all the more. And so, Lord, continue to walk with us each day. Strengthen us. There are those who are sick, those who need your special touch. We ask that you would grant them your blessing. Father, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do.
Yes.
Even as we stand toward the precipice of a new year. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Great is our Lord and of great power. Thy understanding is infinite. Heavenly Father, it's once again that we come with bowed heads and humble this manner that we know how. We come, Father, to just thanking you for this day. Father, we thank you for this food that we are about to receive, for health and strength, these and all blessings that you have bestowed upon you. Us, we say thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
And jump.